Now you see this paper is about audit assurance. So it's very important that the first thing we got to know is actually what is auditing and why they use the word assurance. Okay. Now see, we all know from probably a bit of our understanding or knowledge of this paper called auditing, that audit is about checking of accounts. Okay. Now so when you say checking of account, which is not the right term. Not the right term, but why must we have the accounts checked? And what do you mean by checking of accounts over here? So that's the first thing we're going to see. Now, why is there a need for financial statement audit? Okay, why is there a need for financial statement audit? So what is financial statement audit? Okay, we're going to answer these two questions together, and this will be based on looking at agency perspective. Okay, this is based on agency perspective. So first of all, now what do you mean by agency? Now agency is actually a word that we use to describe an arrangement or a relationship. Okay, so agency is more like a relationship between the principal and agent. Okay, it's a relationship between principal and agent. Now, so this relationship explains that the principal has entrusted the agent to take care of something that belongs to the principal. Because you know, so the whole idea is the principal get the agent to take care of asset belonging to the principal. Alright? Now, this is called agency. Am I right? Okay? Now, so if you apply agency into a company's arrangement, so if you look at agency from a company's point of view, then we will see the relationship between who and who. Principal in a company is, so if you look at a company, we have the shareholder and the director. Agree? Okay, we have the shareholder and the director. So this will be the principal and this will be the agent. Now the relationship is simple, that shareholders are the owners of company, but they themselves do not involve in running the business. Okay, so the shareholders themselves do not run the business. So shareholders will actually appoint directors to act on their behalf. That's why directors are their agent. So the directors will act on their behalf to run the business. So in fact, what the directors are expected to do is to take care of the company. Okay, so we have a very good word that will describe the process of running the business, taking care of the company on behalf of the shareholder. Now that word is called governance. Okay, now the director's job is to govern. Okay, now the word governance, okay, the word governance actually comprise quite a lot of meaning, which include, for example, govern is like controlling, directing, managing, supervising. Now these are all words that we can use to describe governance process. Okay, so your job is to govern. Now that's why the people that they govern, we call them those charged with governance. Okay, now that's the word that you see them in the study. Okay, so you see that. That's why directors are called as those charged with governance. Okay, now, so when the directors govern this company on behalf of the shareholder, you will need to govern it with some objective in mind, okay? So what do we expect from a director is that we call it as a fiduciary duty, all right? So from this instance, we can understand that directors, they have fiduciary duty. So fiduciary means agent, right? So the duty of an agent. So the directors itself will have duty. What do you mean by fiduciary duty? So it's the duty of care, trust, loyalty, that you act in the best interest of the shareholder. You always put the interest of the company first. So that's called a fiduciary duty. So duty of trust, care, loyalty, avoid conflict of interest, put the company's interest first. That's called your fiduciary duty. Alright? Now obviously we believe that all directors must have the duty. But how does directors show to the shareholders that they are observing and they are discharging this duty? So that's why the directors will need to tell shareholders what's happening in the company. Yes, you know? See, by telling the shareholder what's happening in the company, you let them know. For example, if I govern the business very well, the profit goes up. So I can tell you through the profit that profit is increasing. Yes, you know? But if, let's say, over the years, the performance are declining, we make losses, then you can't show to me that you're doing a good governance. So that's why one way of showing to the directors that you are actually governing the business well, you're actually discharging your fiduciary duty, is through your financial reporting. So that is how director discharge accountability to the shareholder. Okay? Now obviously it's not just financial reporting alone. In fact, what we need directors to do is at least once a year come up with an annual report, or on top of those quarterly reports that normally we need if you're a listed company and so on. Okay, so at least once a year come up with an annual report. That in the annual report you must have the financial statement, and that financial statement will tell the shareholder, okay, so all the financial issues. So this is how the shareholder can assess that so far how well director's been doing. Can you see that? But of course the problem is in the reporting process. Now let's say from the annual report that the directors publish, now in this process the issue that we are having is shareholders are having concern over its credibility. Okay, shareholders are having concern over its credibility. So we are looking at whether the directors are telling the truth or not. So what the directors reported here, the shareholders may have doubts, you see. So what we need is to give shareholder certain degree of confidence. So that's what we need to do here. Okay, so what we do is we will get someone outside the company, call it as an external auditor, so that when the directors publish financial statement for the shareholder at the time, the auditor will come and audit. So the whole idea of audit is to do an evaluation, which is to check. Okay, so you're just coming in to audit the financial statement, and after you've audited the financial statement and you tell the shareholder, what do you think? So that is by way of giving an opinion. Now, it's that we do, okay? Now, so this process that you give an opinion with an intention is to enhance shareholders' confidence. So we call this as assurance. Okay? We call this as assurance. See, assurance is about giving people confidence. Is it not? Now, so from this instance, we can understand that the meaning of audit is actually a process. wherein independent auditor will evaluate the financial statement
prepared by the directors. Okay, so it's a process where an independent auditor will evaluate
the financial statements prepared by the directors, and through that evaluation, the auditor will express an audit opinion to the shareholder. Whether now, so you're gonna tell shareholder about something, about what do you think about their account. So how do you tell shareholder about what do you think about the account? Now the technical word that we use is a phrase called true and fairly. Okay, so whether financial statement give a true and fair view.
Okay, now, but when you say a true and fair view, now a view that is true or fair must be based on something. So what is it that we base on?
Now we are based on a reporting framework. So the site is in accordance to an applicable financial reporting framework.
Now, see, that is the whole issue about what we do in audit. Alright, so that's why an audit is a process that we have an independent auditor to come and evaluate financial statement. Okay, now that's why it's important for us to understand actually what do you mean by an independent auditor. So does it mean that if auditor come from outside, then you become independent? So you're going to see that when we cover an issue on ethics, okay? And then when you evaluate financial statement, your job here is to express an opinion, okay? But when you evaluate, how do you evaluate? Now, when you evaluate, you must have some criteria to assess, to tell you whether it's right or wrong. Now, to know whether it's right or wrong, we will have to refer to the framework. Because the framework tells us how accounts should be prepared. So if the framework tells us how accounts should be prepared, now that's how we use to evaluate whether it's right or wrong. So that's why from here we can understand that framework is a basis. Okay, framework is a basis that management uses. That's called a framework. Now this is financial reporting framework. So that's the basis that management uses to prepare financial statement. So what is the financial reporting framework? So what basis that management uses to prepare financial statement? Now we all know that the basis that we use is the accounting standard. Yes or not? So accounting standards is the framework. Okay, now of course besides accounting standard, you may have relevant law that govern how you should present financial statements. So that's why law can also form the framework. Okay, this is an example of financial reporting framework. Now you may even have GAAP, for example. So for issues that you find accounting standards are not covered, then you may have GAAP, the generally accepted accounting practices. Okay, so they are not about standard, but they're practices that if the standards do not cover, we are allowed to accept this kind of practice. Can you see that?
Now these are the framework. Now but framework, there are a lot. See, just look at accounting standard. We have the local standard, we have standards of different country, we have international standard. So that's why the framework that the entity uses must be those which is applicable. So applicable means, i.e., it must be those that is suitable to the entity. Okay? It must be those standard that is suitable
to the entity. Now it is like we are telling you we have a company in Malaysia, all right? We have a company in Malaysia. So let's say there's this X Berhad in Malaysia, but we tell you that X Berhad uses Pakistan accounting standard. Okay, uses Pakistan accounting standard. Now, of course, if you follow the, I don't know what is Pakistan accounting standard, so I just simply say it in case. If you follow their accounting standard in Pakistan to prepare their account, obviously I can say that their accounts got no mistake. But the issue is, why on earth must this Malaysian company in Malaysia uses a Pakistan standard? Unless you got a very special reason, like maybe the holding company is in Pakistan, so the business are majorly carried out in Pakistan, so you may have an exception for that. But if there's no exception, then you find this is terribly stupid, right? Because you know that Malaysian company all in Malaysia but report in Pakistan standard. So when you do that, even though you can say that you follow the standard correctly, but you still don't give us a true and fair view, because the people in Malaysia don't see the same treatment like how people in Pakistan see, you see. So that's why eventually this way is still not acceptable, because the standard is not suitable. So that's why the standard must be relevant, then only you can use to evaluate. Can you see? Okay, now so this is what we call as audit. All right, so audit is about the process of evaluating the financial statements that they prepare, and then to tell the shareholder you believe they give true and fair view. Okay, and of course to say that, you must follow the standards that they use, and that standard must be suitable to their business environment. Okay, now come back to this. See, what auditor does over here is auditor will express an opinion. Okay, so normally what auditor will do is towards the end, when he finishes off the audit, he will prepare an audit report. Now inside the audit report, in the auditor's report, you will see towards the end, at the bottom, one paragraph that will start like this. So the report will say that in our opinion, so now the auditor is telling the shareholder that in our opinion, financial statement give true and fair view. Now, but when you say financial statement give true and fair view, now actually what is true and fair? Now we will have to tell the shareholder that we refer to the position. So when you say position, means you're referring to what? Things that they have in the balance sheet, right? Their asset, their liability, their equity. These are all stated correctly. So the financial position is true and fair. Now the financial performance is true and fair. So performance means you're referring to things you see in the income statement. So the sales are the profit, the expenses are stated correctly, and also their cash flow are true and fair. So you're telling the shareholder that after you've checked their accounts, you believe that all these three things you have here, they're stated correctly. But we start with the word in our opinion. Now that's the first phrase we must understand. We use the word in our opinion. When you say that, using the word in our opinion, that there must be some significance. Okay, there must be some significance that you must know. So when we use this word, what difference do we have? Okay, see, you know? That's why we must interpret the word called true and fair. Okay, we can interpret the word called true and fair. Now first of all, when the word opinion is being used, it implies that auditor is not giving a guarantee to the shareholder. Okay, so when the word opinion is being used, it implies that we are not giving a guarantee to the shareholder. Now again, what did we tell the shareholder? Now we just say that financial statement give true and fair view. So we tell the shareholder that's what we believe. But when we say that, we don't guarantee to the shareholder that what we say is 100% correct, because we just tell them that it's our opinion. You see, now? So this is the issue here, that we're not giving a guarantee because it's just an opinion. You see, now? So there is no absolute assurance. That's what it means, okay? There's no absolute assurance. Now, so when you say that you don't guarantee what you say, then more or less you must let us know to what extent that I should believe in what you say. Okay? So it seems you've got no guarantee, but you more or less must give me a percentage. Like, how much can I believe in you? Okay, see, now, so even though there's no absolute assurance, we still think that there must be a certain degree or level of confidence that auditor shall convey to the shareholder. Okay? There must be certain degree or level of assurance or confidence that you convey to shareholder, that even though you don't guarantee, but how much can shareholder believe in us? Now, so the standard tells us, okay, that whatever we do is based on the international standards on auditing. So the standard tells us that when you do an audit, you will have to do it in such a way that you got to give the shareholder a level of confidence called reasonable. Okay, now we need to give shareholder reasonable assurance. Okay, then what do you mean by reasonable then? Okay, so what do you mean by reasonable? Now what we know very clear now is reasonable is definitely not guaranteed, because you can't give them a guarantee. Okay, that's why you use the word called opinion. Alright, so that what is called reasonable. Now reasonable is a high level of confidence. Okay, that's called reasonable. A high level of confidence. So it's very confident, just that I cannot guarantee, but it's very confident. Okay, now it's a high level of confidence, but it's not necessarily favorable. That's what the standards say. Okay, so a high level of confidence, but it's not necessarily favorable. Meaning, even you can get very high confidence, but we don't guarantee, because there's always possibility that what we say can be wrong. So that's why it's not necessarily favorable. That means not every time we say also correct. Can you say not? Now this is what we do. We will give shareholder reasonable assurance. Now, so from this instance, then we understand. That's why we can tell you that in audit, it's not possible for auditor to guarantee his opinion. Alright, so when we do audit, it's not guaranteed that we can give, okay, it's not possible for us to guarantee the opinion. Now why is it not possible for us to guarantee the opinion? Okay, now that's because we have inherent limitations of audit. Okay, so these are all the things that they are all connected to each other. Okay, so because of inherent limitation of audit. So what do you mean by inherent limitations of audit? Now inherent limitation simply refers to the inherent or the natural weaknesses that we see or we face, because that's how audit is being conducted. Okay, now there are quite a number of reasons that we see as the inherent limitation. All right, now what are those inherent limitations that we see over here that I put down in this case? Okay, now we look at it as number one, due to the nature of financial reporting. Now, see, if you want to guarantee something, then obviously the simple requirement to guarantee is you must be very certain. Something that you're very, very sure. Alright? Now, something that you yourself is not sure, then you can't guarantee. Because you know, this is not certain. There's a lot of possibility. So that's why if you look at financial reporting, we realize that there's actually a lot of things in accounts are not certain. Okay? So we have a lot of uncertainty. And because of the different uncertainties that we face, it gives rise to many possible treatment. Okay, it gives rise to many possible treatment. As a result, we have no way of guaranteeing them. Because you know, now see the example we gave is about issue concerning with, let's say, liability. Alright, now if let's say we have a case over here, I just put at the side, okay. Now, assuming that what happened right now is your client, your entity has a material litigation. Okay? Your entity has a material litigation. Now, someone is taking legal action against your client. Now, so if your client is being sued, now how do you reflect or how do you treat this in their accounts when someone is suing your client? So how do you recognize this? Now, then you have to see what is the chance that you're going to lose this case. So that's why if there's a material litigation, then you will have to assess what is the chance that you're going to lose the case. So when we assess the chance of we losing the case, you realize that the standard tells us if the chance of you losing is 50-50, then what you do here is you will just need to disclose them as contingent, fair enough? So you just need to have a disclosure. That's how you treat. Okay? Now, but if you believe that the chance of you losing is more than 50, that's probable, then the standard tells us that you need to make a provision for it. Now, you see, we have at least two treatments. Now, in fact, if you believe that the chance is remote, then you can even just ignore it. You see, there's so many treatments that we can do now in the account. Just depends on the chance. And the chance is something that we are not sure, is uncertain. So end of the day, you can tell us that the chance is what, but the actual outcome can still be different. So how do you guarantee something that you yourself is not sure? So this is the problem. So that's why, number one, we can't guarantee the opinion is because it's a lot of things in their accounts are uncertain. So we are not sure whether they're doing it the right way or not. Okay? Now, number two, another reason why we can't guarantee is because of the way how we do it. The nature of the audit procedure. Now we call this as the practical limitation. And we also have a legal limitation. Okay, so practical and legal limitation. Now, see, if auditor wants to evaluate whether the client has actually prepared financial statement correctly or not, then you must be able to access their accounting record. You must go and see. So take their documents, then you check. Now, so the practical limitation that we're facing in audit is we may not know whether the client is honest to us. They can always hide all their accounting record and they don't show it to us, and we do not know. So when we checked that time, we thought that everything's at that, but they are hiding some of it. So this is one problem that we can't solve. So practically, we will not know if client hide information from us. Okay?
So if we do not know that they hide information from us, then it's not possible for us to evaluate
if this account is correctly prepared. Okay? Now then number two, we have legal limitation. That even in the fact that we know they are hiding information, we still have a problem that we have no legal power. Example like power to search. Okay, so even though we believe that they are hiding something from us, but you still have no power that you can go and search the premise and stuff like that. So you can't solve the problem, you see. So that's the way how we do audit. Now the third problem is we realize that there is an economic restriction. Okay, so the economic restriction is the restriction of cost
and time. Okay, that when we do audit, we can't deny that there's a budget for us that we need to follow. Okay,
and because that there exists a budget for us to follow, when we do the checking, that's why you learned that the last week about sampling, you see. So why do we sample? Is because we can't afford to check every single thing.
So one, you can't afford to check every single thing, so you sample. Then when you sample, you use projection. Now projection inherently will always have a risk in it, because you are not knowing everything, you're just guessing, because you know.
So this is the restriction that we have. So that example is we will not audit 100%.
So for the part that we don't audit, we're not sure. So these are some of those reasons why we are not able to guarantee. Now since we can't guarantee, then when you tell the shareholder about your opinion, you have to say in such a way that they understand that there's no guarantee. So that's why we start with the word opinion. So you tell them that this is just our opinion, and our opinion is to tell you that we don't guarantee what we say, because you're not. Okay, now so come back to this. See, when the opinion is given, you notice that the opinion is about true and fair view. Okay, now see, what do you mean by true and fair view? See, our opinion is about whether financial statement give true and fair view. Okay? Now, so if I give you a set of financial statement and I ask you to look at this financial statement, then at the end you tell me back, do you think financial statement give true and fair view or not? Now how do you tell? So how do you distinguish an account that is with true and fair and without true and fair? So you must know how to distinguish. If not, how can you give opinion? Because you know, so that's why we must break down for you what do you mean by true and fair. Now see, for us to know what is true and fair, we look for the definition, and we realize that this phrase true and fair has no legal definition. Okay, so there's no legal definition given about what is called true and fair. Now we try to get them to define. All right, so we get the help from the court. Now the court tells us that this is a phrase that we cannot define, because by itself it's a dynamic concept. Okay? So the word true and fair by itself is a dynamic concept. Now what do you mean by a dynamic concept? Now a concept that's dynamic means a concept that is changing. Alright? That is rapidly changing. So what do you think as true today, and what do you think as true tomorrow? You realize that it could be different. So if you look back into the way we look at their accounts, okay, you realize that the way we look at their accounts, when you look at their account,
Now you realize that the accounting treatment that we have now and many years ago, they are all not the same. They've been changing, okay? So the accounting treatments are rapidly changing. Now why must we have accounting treatments that they keep on changing? Why not we just have an accounting treatment that 50 years ago we apply and until today we still apply? But why do you need to change the accounting treatment? Now that's because when we look at the things, our view change. We realize that when you look at something in the past, you probably agree that this is correct. But today you look back again to this same view, you realize that the treatment is no longer correct because you find that it's less appropriate. So that's why it's something that we call dynamic. So that's why the council gave us an idea. The council tell us, instead of telling you what is the meaning of true and fair, the council say, I'll show you what is true and fair. So they just say, to be true and fair, you just need to comply with the standard. Okay? You just need to comply with the standard. Now, why must you comply with the standard? Now, because the standard reflects the correct treatment at that point in time. So, the standard will show what is a true and fair view at that point in time. So you follow what the standard say, okay? You follow what the standard say. So if you follow the standard, then you also follow the requirement of the expectation of the people of what is called true and what is called fair, okay? Now, so once you know that following the standard is a requirement to be true and fair, then we got an idea. So we know, okay, example. Okay? Now, the accounting standard tells us that you need to depreciate your fixed asset. Let's say, okay? Your accounting standard tells us that you need to depreciate your fixed asset. Now, so right now, we have a client. That the client has fixed asset, but the client did not depreciate. Okay? They have fixed asset, but they did not depreciate. Now, why must we depreciate asset? Like if you look back into the logic, the depreciation purpose is because of what? Matching economic useful life of the asset, okay, over the generation of the revenue, as you know. So that's why we believe that if you buy an asset that can last for 10 years, then you will have to match the cost of the asset over 10 years by charging a 10-year depreciation. So that's our belief, as you know. Now, so if you don't depreciate your asset, then we believe that you're doing something that is not consistent with the view of the people. Then you're not doing something that we regard it as true and fair. Because, you know? So that's why the moment you do not depreciate, we believe that you're not being true and fair. So you don't follow the expectation of the people. Now, we will call this as a mistake. Okay? We'll call it as a mistake. So in short, the word is called misstatement. Okay? In short, the word is called misstatement. Now, see, when you have a misstatement, we cannot straight away say that your account is not true and fair because we still need to evaluate the size of your mistake. Now, how big is that mistake in the first place? Now, if let's say, for example, we tell you, if you depreciate, let's say your profit before tax should be 100,000. Now, you did not depreciate, your profit before tax is 100 and let's say 30,000. Now we notice that depreciating and not depreciating gave us a difference of 30,000 over here.
And since we believe a true and fair view is when you depreciate,
So you have overstated your profit by 30,000. So your account is misleading. But if this 30,000 is considered large enough that your financial will become misleading. Okay? If the mistakes that you have here is large enough that it will become misleading, then we will have to tell the shareholder your accounts do not give true and fair view. Can you see not? Then we will say that you will not give true and fair view. That's an idea. Can you see not? So how do you know whether something give true and fair or not? Now you will have to look at whether you follow the accounting standard. And when you look at whether you follow the accounting standard, you must also measure how big is so-called the variant or the mistake. Can you see not? Now, if the mistake is big enough, then we will tell the shareholder that they do not give true and fair view. Can you see not? Now, to measure something big or not big, the term that we use is called material. So we must look at the materiality or the size of the misstatement to judge if something is true and fair. Okay? Now, so this is the first part about explaining to us the concept of what is called auditing. Alright, so when you do audit, this is what happened. Okay? Now you just turn to the back. See case 5 in here. See, we touch on this word called assurance just now, okay? So we need to tell you a bit about what public accountant does. Now you see, all the while the audit firm that we call, they are actually public accounting firm. Okay, so example, the audit firm that we usually say audit firm, they're actually public accounting firm. Okay? Now all these public accounting firm, they provide two range of services that we call them as assurance and non-assurance. Okay, we call them as assurance, non-assurance. Okay, now, so what do you mean by assurance? Okay, I gave an example earlier, like, for example, when we do financial statement audit. Okay. We claim audit is assurance. Okay, so how do you differentiate what is assurance and what is non-assurance? Now, if you follow what the standard says, the standard tells us to know assurance or not, you must look for 5 elements. Okay, now the standard tells us assurance must have 5 elements. Okay, so when you have all the 5 elements, then you call it assurance. Now, if you don't have the 5 elements, then you don't call it assurance. So you say you must have 5 elements. Now, what are the 5 elements that we see here? Okay, we're going to look at what's the 5 elements. Now, these 5 elements will be, number 1, you need to have a 3 party relationship. Okay, so all assurance engagement must have 3 party relationship. Now what do you mean by 3 party relationship? Now who are the 3 party? First, we need a professional accountant. Okay, one of the party must be the professional accountant. Now, so I'm going to use example of audit, okay? If we apply financial statement audit engagement. So who are the 3 party? Okay, the accountant actually is the auditor. Now besides the accountant, we need user. So in this case, shareholder, and we must also have a responsible party. So the responsible party would be directors. Now the three parties over here, all of them will have something to do with a common subject. So we call it as a subject. Okay, so three of them are surrounding a common subject. So what do you mean by a common subject? Now this common subject tells us it's a subject that the responsible party prepared. So who do they prepare this for? Now they're preparing it for a user that will be using that subject. But because the user will have doubts over the credibility, that's why we need an accountant to come and evaluate the subject. So that's why the subject is a common subject that the responsible party prepare, where user will use them and accountant will evaluate. So in this case, if it's an audit, the subject will be financial statement. Okay, now see, we will evaluate the subject. So in order for you to evaluate, we need to have some kind of measurement to assess them. We call it as criteria. So criteria refers to the standard that we use to evaluate the subject. Okay, so the standards that we use to evaluate the subject, now we call them as criteria. Alright? Now, so in this case, if it's an audit, now what criteria that we use to evaluate if financial statements are correctly prepared? Now, we are using the accounting standard. Agree enough? So example, IFRS. Okay, if you follow IFRS, then you can tell have the financial statement been prepared correctly. So that's where criteria comes in. So we're looking at it as IFRS, the framework to evaluate financial statement. Now the evaluation will bring us to the end. The end result is to give an opinion. Can you see not? Now, so the opinion has to be in the form of written assurance report. Now, the written assurance report, it's the auditor's report, where in the report, it has audit opinion. Okay, so in the report, it has audit opinion. Okay, now, but of course, to come up with this opinion, we will have to go through a process. Now, we call it as the engagement process. Now what do you mean by an engagement process? Now that's the process that we do in the audit so that we can evaluate their account. So we say that these are the approach that we have used to collect evidence. So what approach that the auditor uses, it will all be inside the auditing standard. So that will be the auditing framework. So for example, we have the ISA. So the ISA will tell us how to do the audit. Then based on the ISA, we will get the evidence by evaluating using the standard, then we can give an opinion. Okay. Now all assurance will be able to have these five elements. So if you have any engagement that you do not have these five, you call them as non-assurance already. Okay. Now so far in your study, what are those assurance engagement that you need to know? Okay, so for your awareness, you must know that assurance engagement. The types of assurance engagement include doing an audit, doing a review. Okay, so audit is also assurance and review is also assurance. Now, what's the main difference between doing an audit and doing a review? Now, actually, the work that we do are more or less the same. Audit or review also involves so-called checking their accounts, and then you will give a report and tell what do you think about their account. Now, the only difference is when you do audit, you will tell the shareholder an opinion that carry reasonable assurance. So that's the main difference. You're going to give reasonable assurance to the user. So it's very high confidence, okay? Whereas if you do a review, after you so-called check their accounts, you will also give a conclusion to the user. But this conclusion that you give to user will only carry negative, or we call it as moderate assurance. So that's the main difference that we see over here. Okay? So what's the difference? The level of confidence is different. So this one is high confidence. This is moderate confidence. Now why is it moderate confidence? Because the amount of work we do here is always much lesser than the work we do on top. Now because you do less work, you will naturally give user less confidence, okay? Now, so besides audit review, there's also one more engagement that is assurance-based. We call it as examination of prospective financial information. Now, what is this examination of prospective financial information? See, besides preparing financial statement about the past, we can also prepare financial information about the future. Now, you don't call it financial statement, so we call it as prospective financial information. That's about the future. Now, example, you can prepare a forecast. Okay. Now, usually these are things are required. For instance, maybe you would like to take a bank loan. Then you need the bank to assess whether they want to give a loan to you. So you want to show to the bank that you're able to make money, earn profit, and then pay back the loan. So you prepare them a forecast. Now, but when you prepare a forecast, now you know a forecast is what you think about the future. You can put anything inside. It's something that has not happened. So that's why, what else can we do so that we can make the user feel more confident with the forecast that we prepare, so that they can at least trust us more, so we can also get an auditor to check the forecast. So the auditor will of course tell the bank whether this forecast, when they prepare, is there anything that they feel is wrong. Okay, now, so that's why auditor will come here and examine. And then after examine, the auditor will also give a negative conclusion about the forecast. Okay, there's an example of how assurance may come in. Okay, now all these are the issues to start off to tell us a bit about what is called audit. Alright, now, so far we understand the purpose of audit. We know what is in audit, the process of evaluating account. Then we're going to give opinion. Opinion carry reasonable assurance. What is reasonable? I've explained all that for you, okay? Now, these are all the things that we do in chapter 1, all right? Now, we're going to move on and look at chapter 2, okay? Now, why must we look at chapter 2? Now, how will this link to our study? Now, you see, we mentioned earlier that external auditor has to be an independent auditor. Okay?
Okay, an external auditor has to be an independent auditor.
So actually the phrase independent, okay, the phrase independent, what does it mean?
So what do you mean by an independent auditor? Now if you want to understand the phrase called independent,
you must first understand the ethical value that we need being an auditor. Okay, see now? So to look at this, you must first understand that as a professional accountant, we need to observe the fundamental principle of the association and the profession. Okay? So as accountant, you have to observe the fundamental principle of the association or the profession. Okay? Now besides observing the fundamental principle, we also have a lot of rules about your moral standard that you need to observe as well if you take on different engagement. For example, if you do an audit, then you must also observe extra rule. So that's where we add on that if let's say you want to act as an auditor, then you also need to observe the rule on integrity, objectivity, independent. So you have additional rules to observe because you want to act as an auditor to take on an audit engagement. So the rules will tell us what do you mean by independent. So they say it all starts from ethics. Because yeah, it all starts from ethics. Now we're going to start with the first part. See, all the professional accountant, regardless of whether you do audit or not, you must first have the fundamental principle. Okay, so what are the fundamental principle first of all? Now to help you guys to remember, we look at a mnemonic called COPIP. Okay, so we have COP. COP is police. That's how you remember. Okay, COP is police. All right, now what is COPIP? Now what does it stand for? Now C, it's about the principle of confidentiality. Okay, the C, principle of confidentiality, which means you will not reveal the secret of your client. Okay, you will not reveal the secret of your client. All right, now we have the principle of objectivity. Okay, the principle of objectivity. Now what do you mean by objectivity? Say objective, it's to do with judgment. So anything that you need to exercise judgment, we use the word called objective. So being objective is about being fair. Is it not? Being objective is about being fair. You must be fair, but you must not be biased. That's called objective. Okay? Okay, then we have a P here. Now this P is actually professional competent. Okay, so the P here is about professional competent. Now so what do you mean by professional competent? Competent refers to skill. Okay, skill, expertise. Can you do the work or not? That's called competent. Can you say that? Competent means your skill, your expertise. Now we look at competence in two ways. Alright, so the principle says that every professional accountant must acquire the degree of competence that they need and then maintain it. So there are two requirements that we need here: acquire and maintain. Okay, you must acquire and you need to maintain.
date. So acquire, how do you acquire competency? Now what you're doing now is called acquiring, studying, passing exam. So when you pass your exam, you must work, get your experience. Now this is the process of acquiring the minimum competency to do your work. Now once you graduated and then once you've got the experience, you've got your membership, then you realize that every year you must still go for training. So the training is to maintain your competence. Okay, now that's the requirement here about competence. Now I, it's on integrity. So integrity refers to a principle of being honest. Don't tell lies. That's called integrity. So we have wording like honest, honesty, being truthful. Okay, being truthful, being straightforward. Okay, a bit small the word, squeezing, being straightforward. Okay, having fair dealing. Now these are all about integrity. Okay, these are all about integrity. Now for example, yesterday they announced petrol price go up 30 cents, is it not? So all jokers go and pump petrol before the price increase. Now but there are also petrol stations that they buy the stock earlier. So if they sell yesterday, they sell at 1.9. But they sell after midnight, they sell at 2.1. So a lot of petrol stations, some not very honest ones, will start telling that their petrol stock out. Okay, although it's illegal, they cannot do that, but some of them are doing that. They just tell you got no petrol, they don't sell. Now why they're doing that? Because they want to earn more. Now will you agree that when they do that, their practice is not honest? Of course, right? That's where your fair dealing shows that your integrity is not there. Because you're not, honest, you want to make more money, you're greedy. Okay? Now the last P is professional behavior. Okay? The last P is professional behavior. Okay, so what do you mean by professional behavior? That means you must behave very professionally. So you must act with courtesy. Okay, you must do things which are illegal. You must not do things which are illegal. These are all the fundamental principles. So to be a professional accountant, we must have all the five. So you cannot violate them. All right, you cannot violate them. Now we have a short case in this example here. Now the case contains some of the issue that it will actually relate to the fundamental principle that we've just discussed. So we need you to identify of the five fundamental principle, which one are replicable in the case. And then we ask again, how Jessica's objectivity could have been threatened. Now again, objectivity is about being fair, that you should not be biased. So what do you believe that in the case that will make her become biased? Now we're going to read the case, okay? Then we see what we hear. Now, see, Jessica is currently pursuing her professional papers in ACCA and is being employed as an audit assistant with Peter. Jessica has been assigned to audit XYZ PLC, where she is given very short time to complete her task, which she finds it insufficient for proper audit to be completed. Now, while auditing inventories, Jessica discovered what she felt as irregularities. Now when she queried the management of XYZ, the general manager is extremely friendly to her, explaining that accounts are proper, but because Jessica is new to her job and the client, she's unfamiliar with the systems and recording. So the general manager said an explanation will be given directly to her partner, and Jessica accepted the response without taking further action.
Now, on a separate matter, Jessica found out that XYZ PLC is at the final stage of signing a contract with a major customer that will significantly increase its profit. Now, this information, once announced to the public, will lead to increase in its share price. So Jessica has asked her sister to buy shares in XYZ. Now, that's the case. So if you look at the case, now we're going to see of the case that we have here, which of the five principles that will affect us in the case. Now, what are those things that probably she shouldn't do, but she did, that is affecting her ethical value? Now, the first thing, which probably very obvious, is the fact that she asked her sister to buy the share of the company because she has leaked out the information. Can you see that? She has leaked out the information. All right. Now, so what principle when you leak out information? Which principle is that? Principle of confidentiality. Okay. Now, she has leaked out that the contract signing and has asked her sister to buy share in XYZ. Okay. Which, of course, professionally, you cannot do that, right? Now, why is it wrong that we say that leaking out all this information, it's against the interest of the client? How is it affecting the client? Now, you think and see. Okay. No matter how small the risk is, but there's always a chance that if she leaked this out to her sister, and the sister go and leak out to more people, and before the contract being signed, the rumor spread. And once the rumor spread, imagine there are other people who heard of this and think that instead of get XYZ to sign with them, why not we go and sign with them and offer a better price? So a competitor approached the customer and undercut. So as a result, XYZ failed to get the deal. Now you can see this example of why, if you have not acted professionally, you can affect your client very adversely. Can you see that? So that's why this is one principle that she violated. She has not observed confidentiality. Now, number two. Now, we noticed that she did complain about her time. She said that this job, very short time to complete. Now, why she finds it very short time to complete? Now, there are two possibilities. Either one, really, that the job is really very complex. You need more time, but the time given is not enough. But on number two, it's because you find it too difficult. That's why if I give you, for example, you just imagine, I give you a simple max question. Like say 37 times 38. Calculate the answer without calculator. But you can do it for me. But you take this number, go to a standard 3 student and say calculate the answer. Probably you find it difficult, because they are not so good compared with you. So that's why probably this has reflected issue of professional competence. That insufficient time to complete the task may indicate that the competency level is inadequate. That she's been asked to do something that she cannot handle. Now, that's issue about competence. Now, another principle we can see that actually affected her fundamental principle is the part that they say she realized there's some irregularities, and she finds that the manager is friendly to her, and the manager says, it's okay, don't worry, I'll tell your partner straight, and she accepted without further questioning. That means she didn't do anything else after that. There's no follow-up. She just agreed. She just believed. Okay, so now she's being biased. She's being biased because by right, you must also go and follow up what will happen after that. That is it true the manager really explained to the partner? Is it true that the issue has been resolved? But she did not. Okay, so we also notice this is a problem to do with objectivity. Now, what problem that we see here is the fact that she has lost a value called professional skepticism. Okay, so as an auditor, you must have professional skepticism. So this is an inquiring mind. So a mindset that if you come across anything not right, you must question, you must ask. But she did not, okay? So that's why the case mentioned that she accepted without taking further action. When in fact, she didn't even see what explanation is that. She didn't go through the evidence. She just listened to a very simple remark that the general manager will explain directly. And then she disagreed, okay? So these are examples of how her fundamental principles have been affected, okay? Okay, so we go back and look at the issue again. Now, because this is an audit, all right, this is an audit. Now, being an auditor, objectivity is very important, okay? So when you do audit, you must not be biased because your duty is to express opinion to shareholder. Okay, now the moment you need to tell someone about what you believe in, if you're being biased, then people will not trust what you say. So if you want the people to trust in you, then it's very important that you must stay objective. So that's why we're looking at objectivity. But when you look at the case, you probably will come across there must be some kind of situation that may influence your objectivity. So we are looking at how. That means we are looking at what condition or what matters that can influence Jessica's objectivity. So what is it that it will actually influence her objectivity that eventually she could become biased? Okay, now what is it? Okay, example. See, number one, that we notice that the general manager is being very friendly to her. Okay? Now, the feeling that you find someone is very pleasant, that you like the person, that naturally you will have trust in what the person says. So you will no longer have doubts in that person. You will not challenge the person. So this is itself a problem that may cause her to be biased. That if she finds the general manager pleasant, can be trusted. Now that itself would have affected the mindset. So this is one factor, okay? So as an auditor, you must stay a distance. Of course, you can be friendly, but you must remember that you're going to stay a distance. So you must not let relationship influence you. Now, number two. Now we notice that her sister acquires shares in XYZ. Okay, the sisters acquire shares in XYZ. Now, what's the problem when the sisters acquire shares in XYZ? Now, if there's any problem in the audit, okay, if there's any problem in the audit, then the share price will drop. Okay, if there's any problems that we see in the audit,
then share price will drop. Now, obviously, if share price will drop, the sisters who have share in the company will suffer a loss. Now, so if Jessica is aware of that, that if really Jessica do the audit and come across a problem, you think and see, Jessica may not want to reveal it because she's thinking of her sister's interest. So this is a problem. So if Jessica do the audit, she may not reveal it if she discovers problem. Why? Because she's thinking of protecting the investment of the system. Now, so this could have affected her objectivity. Now, number three, even her incompetency could be a factor that affects her objectivity. Now, why being incompetent will affect her objectivity? Because by not being competent enough, it's very likely she will fail to get sufficient, appropriate audit evidence. Okay, and not able to get sufficient appropriate evidence, which is what we need to express your opinion, then it's very likely that the opinion that we express is obviously affected. Okay, so this will affect quality of your opinion subsequently. Now, these are examples of the problem that we see in the case that eventually may affect objectivity of Jessica. Okay, now, so that's a bit about fundamental principle. Now, we're gonna move a bit further and look here. Okay, now the main issues that we need to see in audit, it's the principle called objectivity, integrity, and independence. Okay, let's just turn to the next page. See, point 7. Now, see what happened is audit is an assurance engagement. Okay, audit is assurance. Now, assurance engagement involves expressing, now in terms of audit, you gotta express opinion. See, opinion that you express has to be credible. Now, you ask yourself a question. So, why must people trust what auditors say? Okay? So, what makes you so special that people will believe in what you say? So, you ask yourself a question. Okay? So, why must the people out there believe what we say? Can you say not? Now, so the reason why that they all have belief in us, that we are credible, is because auditor has objectivity, that is beyond doubt. So in the mindset of the people out there, is they always agree that auditor is someone objective. That auditor is a person who is fair. Auditor must not tell lies. So how do you convince people that we are objective? That's very important, okay? Then if you cannot convince people your objectivity, then how can you expect people will have trust in you? So that's why, to make them believe in our objectivity, so auditor shall be and appear to be independent of whatever influences or whatever conflict of interest that may affect rational objectivity. Now, so to have people believe in us, to trust us, this is what we need. We need to be
and we need to appear to be. Now, being and appear to be is obviously two different issues. Now, to be, it's the independent of mind. Okay? Being independent refers to our independence of mind. And appear independent is our independence of appearance. So what do you mean by independence of mind and independence of appearance? Now, independence of mind refers to your capability that you will stay objective, that you will not be biased inside your mind. So that's called mind, because it's inside your mind. So if you have a situation, now will you be biased or not? So if you yes or no, that's your mind. So that's why the independence of mind is very critical for you to preserve quality of your judgment. Okay? Now, whether you're able to come out with quality judgment, you're looking at independence of mind. Now, there was independence of appearance. Now, this is how people look at you. So, appearance is how they look at us. So, the independence of appearance is important because we need this for public confidence. So, whether or not that people will trust us depends on how we appear to them as being independent or not independent. Okay? Now, but we know out there, there's a lot of situations or circumstances that may give rise to threats to both of these independent. But we call them as the threats to auditors independent. Now, all these threats are being classified into five. Okay? So, we classified them into five. There are five types of threats. Okay, I'll call it as self-interest, self-review, intimidation, familiarity, advocacy. Now, the threats that we say here, they will all be capable of making you biased. Understand, okay? The threats that we see here, they will all be capable of making you biased. They will make you become unfair. Okay? They'll make you become choosing side, that you will not stay neutral. So in which way that they will make you become biased? That's why you must look at which category. So self-interest refers to those threats that you become biased because you're thinking of your personal gain. This is called self-interest. So if I think that my personal gain is more important, so that I become biased, it's called self-interest. Now review threat, self-review is a threat occur because you need to review your own work. So you've done something, then you got to check back your own work, then you got to give back your own opinion on your own work. This is called self-review. You review back your own work. Now, intimidation are those cases that you're being threatened. And as a result of being threatened, you become afraid. So once you become afraid, then you're going to tell lies. That's called intimidation. You see, you know? Now, familiarity is those cases like earlier, for example, your sister. Your sister's own share, and you're thinking of she's your sister. Now, if it's not your sister, you wouldn't be bothered, right? But because it's your sister, so you want to protect her. So this is because of relationship. Now, advocacy is a threat that occur because you are in the position that you need to defend your client, okay? Now, we're going to see how defending client may also give rise to a threat. Now, there are four examples I gave here that relates to different threats that we see on top, okay? Now, first of all, now, they say that the client, it's a holiday operator, okay? They are a tour company, okay? Now, the audit partner has been given a free stay in a luxury holiday villa for a week. So now this is what they give it to your partner, okay? So since you are a holiday operator, so you tell the partner, hey, I got this villa, very nice one, I just go and stay for 1 week, free, don't need to pay. Now, will this affect the partner's objectivity? Now, do you think that as a result of getting this holiday villa for free, that if you are the partner, so you become biased? Now, if you think yes, in which way? Now, example, we believe that the threat could have affected you through self-interest. Okay? The threat could have affected you through self-interest. Now, why self-interest? Okay, number one. See, when someone offers you some good things, you'll be tempted and you want it. Can you see that? And we always know that when someone offers something, they want something in return. So you must be exchanging. For example, you might be exchanging a favor. Can you see that? So in this case, the self-interest threat could occur in a way that you're accepting a personal benefit, a gift, or you can say it's a gift. Okay, you're accepting a gift and you're being greedy, you want it. Okay, so when you accept this personal benefit, then usually auditor is expected to return a favor. Now, in which way that you can return a favor? By being biased. For example, close one eye when you do the audit. Even though there's a problem in their accounts, you just don't bother. Overlook the issue, okay? Now, see, this is one of the way that how offering you a free holiday would have affected your objectivity. Now, actually, it's not only offering you a holiday may affect objectivity from this instance. Now, even if you look at intimidation. Okay, we can also see that threats could occur from intimidation. Now, in which way that intimidation could have occurred? Now, the client may threaten to disclose that auditor has accepted some gift. If auditor refuses to assist them. Assist, of course, in this manner means to give them the favor. Okay? So since you're not gonna help them, then probably they get very angry, then they threaten that I will expose this issue and get the whole world to know. Then that's another possibility that why you become biased, because you're afraid that you'll be exposed. So that is intimidation. Okay? Now, actually, number three. Now, the third way will probably affect you in different manner. Okay? That we are looking from the point that in the first place, why would a partner give you a holiday? So probably you say that it's not about getting a favor. It's just very nature. We just give you a holiday. No reason. Give you a holiday. But that could also indicate that if like that, the partner and the client probably are very close friends. That's why they are so close to the extent that, come on, I give you a free holiday. It's okay, you just take that. So this kind of instance may indicate another problem, that you may have a familiarity threat. That actually the view is the partner is very close with the management, that to the extent that they're giving you goodies. So they're very close. And being so close may also give rise to doubt that by being so close, will the auditor actually defend the management? But in the event if your accounts got problem, that will you just give way, close one eye, this kind of problem that we see over here, okay? Now, so this is an example of a situation that we notice different threats occur and why we see that there are threats occur over here. Okay? Alright, now we take a short break, come back, then we continue.